Hello and welcome to another channel Fireball video. I'm Vince of Sons Pleasant Kenobi on the Internet, the Magic, the Gathering content creating equivalent of the Trash Man. I'm just there digging around in the trash, eating old discarded rotten apples, wearing nothing but a leotard. And today, I'm bringing back black-green mid-range, or black-green monsters as I sometimes call it, to Historic. We had the addition of Kaladesh Remastered very recently, so I've decided to play a bit of Historic. And that gave us Noxious Gearhulk for this deck. And I'm playing a singular copy of Fatal Push. If you're asking the question, why play mid-range, or what is mid-range? Mid-range is a collection of removal spells, some things that draw cards, and then green or black cards that have too much text on them. The only cards that don't have that are your bottom end. Even your Gilded Goose has actually got, like, you know, half a paragraph on it. But Land of White Elves is the simplest card in the deck, barring your basic lands. Besides that, every card should have at least three lines of text, preferably their own separate instances of text. Questing Beast is probably the greatest of all mid-range cards. This card here is the Rock Incarnate, but of course Planeswalkers fit that bill. Cavalier of Thorns. I mean, I don't even know what the second ability does. I'm not going to read it. This is the deck. If you like the video, don't forget to hit the like button, drop a comment down below, and have a little chat in the comment section about which play was the best, or at which point you stopped watching the video because you think you're better than everyone else. If you enjoy the content, you can always check me out on youtube.com/PleasantKenobi. And if you're picking up anything from channelfireball.com, especially things during the Black Friday promo deals coming up next week, or I guess when this video comes out, that might have been yesterday. I'm not sure, but if you're enjoying the content or want to pick some bits up, you can put the code Kenobi in at checkout to help support the channel. With that out of the way, let's play some best of three. Yeah, I've mainly played best of one with this because that's what Arena was designed for, right? Who knows how it will go? Round and round it goes. Where will it stop? Nobody knows. Did you know you can mute your opponent's emotes by clicking their avatar and choosing mute? That's good to know. Just muted myself there to cough. Don't want to cough directly into the microphone. That's considered bad recording etiquette. It's not very friendly for the end user. This is the longest I've ever queued for a game in Arena. What is going on? It's normally like a 10-second queue at most, right? I'm gold, by the way. This isn't because I'm like top tier platinum or anything. Here we go. I'm gold. My opponent is bronze. That's probably because of how long it took to queue. We're going to play first. We want to see some dorks or some ramp. We're gonna keep this. It's slow, I'm not gonna lie. If our opponent could run us over with mono red, or goblins, or the Auras deck. So far, the problem I've been finding is that we aren't the best mid-range deck because we're not playing Uro and Nissa Who Shakes the World, but you can't play the same cards all the time. I know the design of Magic suggests that you should. I know the design of Magic wants you to play Uro in every single format, but I'm just not into it enough to do that. I would literally rather play a different game entirely than play the same cards in every format all the time. Temple of Malady. Here we go. Thoughts is on top. Yeah, let's have a look at what our opponent's working with before we cultivate on turn three. Our opponent has Mulligant. They start with a tap Breeding Pool. We're going to have a look at their hand to see if we need to fake a Fatal Push. Oh, look, it's... it's Uro. Okay, this isn't very useful against us. This is good at killing our Planeswalker. I guess we'd hit the Krasis. Although the Uro gives him something to do early. I'm going to take the Uro. Feels bad though, doesn't it? Thought Seizing an Uro feels bad. So our opponent's on the blue, green, black mid-range plan. As I mentioned, it's probably better than our plan. Let's be real. Let's cultivate here. Just grabbing two of each basic, one of each basic, put the forest to play. I'm going to see a 1-1 Hydroid Krasis here. No, we're not. Okay, we're just going to keep playing lands then. Annoyingly, both of our creatures here can't be casted for our Garenbrig. So, yeah, questionable Garenbrig, I guess. I guess I just slam a Wormcoil Engine. A Massacre Worm. They can kill it. It's going to cost them 4 mana next turn. They did mass a land drop. If we get to untap and play Henge, then we're laughing. I have a funny feeling we're not going to see a lot of one mana dorks and small creatures, so that's why I'm valuing the Noxious Gearhulk later over this worm. Okay, they drew Vraska's Contempt. They still have Blood Chief's Thirst. We drew one of our removal spells. Oh, I don't really want to play the Gearhulk for no value, honestly. I think I'm gonna pass the turn. I don't know if playing nothing is the correct thing to do, but I don't know if just playing out our ETB kill spells is... Yeah, okay, at least we get to kill something now. This is good. I drew a singular card off the Krasis. We're gonna go... Gearhulk, kill the Krasis. Play a Goose? Again, if we untap with a Gearhulk, we slam a Henge, then every creature there on out is a card draw. But they're gonna Blood Chief's Thirst, right? No, they have a second Vraska's Content. Put things in exile. We do get things back with our Green Cavalier. So exile's not the best place to see things go. The thing with Blood Chief's Thirst is that it can kill our Ugin as well. So we kind of need to get this card out of their hand before we can play our Ugin. Just slamming a Henge here, I guess. They might have counter magic, honestly, but I mean, I can't do nothing. I can't play the Ugin. Okay, we're going to be gaining life every turn. All we need to do now is just draw creatures and have them resolve. Even if they kill them, we still get the card advantage out of obviously playing them. Because Great Henge is a glimpse of nature at all times. That's pretty wild when you think about it. Ashiok. Okay. We're going to have a turn on land from it to our hand and make us exile something. Are they going to make a body? Him. What is their plan here? If it returns to hand, I might be tempted to let the Ugin go and keep the Henge, because the Henge will cross into the game where the Ugin's currently at the mercy of their Blood Chief's Thirst. Yeah, okay, we're going to make some mana and gain some life there. This goes back to hand. Discard the Ugin. Whilst Ugin will definitely win us the game at some point along the line, so will the Henge. Both of them given enough time, but we still need to get rid of the Blood Chief's Thirst. So if we draw a land, we can go Maelstrom Pops and Henge. I guess we bait with the Henge because we want the Pulse to resolve, and they shocked themselves, didn't they? Oh, we don't have a food off the Goose, do we? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. So we can't... Let's just pulse the Ashok. I don't think they're going to have count. Well, why would they shock themselves? Just a growth spiral? It's just going to be a growth spiral. Okay. No attacks. We get to make a food at the end of their turn. They've got two removal spells and something else in their hand. They're one card off of casting the Uro, and we don't have an answer to it in hand. So I guess they want to kill our Goose just so they can cast an Uro here. That would be the most... sensible thing. Uro, of course, replacing himself, gaining them three. No, they're just drawing a Tamiyo. Okay. Rough. Speaking of mid-range cards with too much text on them, here we have an opponent playing the exact same thing, but they're heavier into blue. Well, they're heavier into blue than we are. They're just quite into... We're not in blue at all. We're not in blue at all. Sharknado is part of their deck. So we're going to see an Uro next turn, and we've still got a Tamiyo to deal with as well. This is rough. The Great Henge in our hand isn't doing anything. I guess Ugin could have bolted the Tamiyo before getting killed. So we can go Questing Beast and have it die. Obviously, the other way around here would allow the Great Henge to cantrip our Questing Beast, but we just didn't have the mana to play both this turn. We're going to eliminate our Gilded Goose. Was that a misclick? Like, oh, because they can't thirst this turn. Okay. That'll slap them for four and knock the Tamiyo down a peg. Violence is impolite. So we have a Henge in play now. So if we just draw creature after creature after creature, we'll be all good. A Noxious Gearhulk would be amazing, but we're only playing one. The main thing to do when you're playing mid-range is to ensure that you only play one-offs. Because that's what a real mid-range deck does. It plays a load of crazy one-offs for no apparent reason. Here's an Uro. They're going to draw a card, gain life, and they still get to activate Tamiyo. I forget about Tamiyo's static text. I literally forget that's a thing. So let's not have that. Okay, we're going to lose Questing Beast. That makes sense. As expected. They have two cards in hand we don't know about now. They're going to name... What are they naming with Tamiyo? I missed it last time. Mr. Who Shakes the World. Ugh. Okay, we need to draw something good. No. Okay. Fun. We're playing 23 lands. Which means that I sometimes flood and sometimes don't hit my third land. There's no in between. That's not true. I've just had a chain of wins dip back into gold for this season. This is like the second time I've played historic this since Amonkhet released. Since Kaladesh released. Okay, so they have 9 power in play. So the game's over pretty soon now. I guess top decking another Ugin and down ticking would be our way out of this. Although it would leave the Overgrown Tomb creature alive. Even though Ugin would then die to that. So Ugin doesn't win us. It just gets us out of it. We have one more copy of Ugin in our deck. Mask of Worm is gone. Noxious Gearhulk is gone. That's a Hydro Crisis for 7. I'm just going to crack my Fatal Passage now to slightly increase our chance of actually drawing a relevant card. Like, creatures are good too, because if we just draw creature after creature after creature, we can play our whole board. But we are under a lot of pressure here. Tamiyo's going to name... Do I still get flashback to Tamiyo naming Nexus of Fate? God, that was a fun time, wasn't it? Seagate Restoration. Okay, no, didn't hit it. Gain the life. I might just crack this food now, honestly. Draw a Garruk. Doesn't draw us any cards, but does kill a body. Killing the Ura doesn't do anything. So I guess we just make some bodies. Garruk has outperformed my expectations a lot in this deck, but this is a bad showing for him. It's a bad showing for him. He's going to get murdered by the Krasis. If we don't die before that. Harness the elements. God, the Ur attack trigger. It's gonna kill us. Bury us with card advantage. Oh. I'm gonna kill our Garruk with their, no, they're gonna kill a wolf for some reason. That doesn't seem efficient. But I guess it leaves them with mana to do more things now. Maybe downticking Garruk was correct. Kill a flyer, draw a card, perhaps draw another creature. This is power life total by 13 points, though. Okay. Okay, let's draw something relevant. Creatures and Ugins. Creatures and Ugins. That's a creature. So let's go for Pelucanos Unchained. He'll be a 7/7. They obviously got more removal in hand. Okay. This doesn't actually find anything, I don't think. So we have to keep it in hand and use our mana more wisely, I think. That's a 7/7. So I can kill an Uro here, which isn't great. We're going to activate it now so we can kill one thing on their turn and one thing on our turn as well. We're going to kill Uro here. And then if they have a removal spell, they just kill it. They don't. Oh, I forget that it loses the counters. Yes. Okay. Growth Spiral from our opponent. What am I doing? We're so dead. We need to literally draw like creature after creature after creature. And some of those creatures need to be Massacre Worms and Noxious Gearhulks, but it's too late for that. Okay. The land shall conquer you. Maybe we can deck them. They have 19 cards left in their hand. They thought seized us. So that cultivate had value being in hand. I think we might have one more basic left in our library, to be fair. Let's block. Here. So we get to unearth it and then fight the Hydra Crisis, then die? To the library. Tamio is going to grab them. What are they naming? Blood Chief's Thirst. Okay, well that new was our Pelucranos plan. Oh, it's sorcery speed. Okay. Let's go land on our elves. Draw a card. Let's go Garrick's Harbinger. Do we keep doing this? How much mana is he to unearth? Only 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11 mana. So we can still play this and be left with 7. 11 minus 3 is only 8. So we're going to play Pelucranos and fight. Let's go for it. Let's just keep digging. There's the trophy we want. I don't know. I didn't even know what I exiled there. I'm just thinking we need to go to game too soon. So we can fight with Pelucranos here. We can trophy Anissa. We have to kill the 7-7 because we're on 7. They're saying good game. It's a bit preemptive, really, isn't it? Unless they have multiple removal spells. Sure. Pass to blockers. Block here, block here, block here. Trophy the Crisis. Now that they've GG'd, I kind of have to keep going, right? Also, during combat, I could have fought with the Pelucranos there and not got hit by the sorcery. So I assume there's a Vraska's Contempt in their hand or something. This kills 2 of the bodies. That's not terrible. I mean, we've got to deal with another Uro extinction level event. Okay, they're going to choose even to get rid of the Pelucranos. That's fair. They can't Blood Chief this Garrick's Harbinger because of protection from black. They can just make an Uro. They're going to ultimate Nissa and then play Nissa? Yeah. See, if they'd done that pre-combat, all their lands would have been indestructible. So that was quite a severe missequence. But they will have an indestructible 3-3 now. So the game is kind of over. Not because of the 3-3, but that and the Uro. They didn't cast an Uro this turn. They still can, right? No, they can't. Okay, they have horribly missed. Oh, they could. I missed a green mana in the pool somewhere. I should be dead. I really should. Okay. I keep going with this rodeo. No attack. I mean, Ugin is still very, very good. Like, doesn't deal with the lands though. There's 2 lands now. We can block one of them. Mask Curl would be good. It wouldn't be good in this circumstance. It would be good when we had like an elf in play and stuff like that. But Mask Curl is also on our sideboard. They've only got 9 cards left in their library. Maybe decking them is our answer. Block here. And then trophy the Uro. And then Field of Ruin their Vantress. See if we get another land out of them. Maybe they... Well, we're getting so many 3-3s. I mean, They scry two to the bottom. They've got a handful of cards as well. We do have one more land left.
Cool.
We take three here. Go to six. You've got a ton of mana and a ton of cards in hand still. We need a top deck a card that mills them. I don't think we have anything in our deck that does that. God, if we top deck a Vital Forces. Oh, they're going to draw two more. Okay, well, we're dead to the flyer. Go on. Uptick Tabio. You know you want to. Oh, no. Okay. Let's go to get sideboarding them. Surprisingly close, but not on life totals, right? We're going to go with a couple of scoozers. No, we don't want duresses. We'll keep our thought scissors in. I guess trophy is better than push in this matchup, that's for sure. What don't we want in this matchup? Does Cog look good? No, it's good. Fighting Hydra Crises and Uroes is bad. Crises even. So we're going to cut the two Coglers. We'll cut one of the Coglers, not bring the other one in, should I say. Maybe a Ceratops as well. But the Plowbrew's not relevant against the lands. Nissa is a problem. How do we deal with Nissa? Jurassic from hand? This act is fine. It can kill lands and the creatures. Well, we can't kill a really big Hydro Crisis. Mask of Worm being weak here. Okay. Let's try that again. Getting pared down and then getting brutalized by all the blue-green mythics in the world. We're going to play first. We're going to keep this. I think Garrick's Harbinger is going to be really good against their black removal spells. So we don't really have a turn two play, so we're just going to go to Overgrown Tomb, Thoughtseize them. Temple of Malady, turn two. Growth Spiral, Extinction Event, and Uro. Take the Extinction Event. It gives them a way to kill our Harbinger, which we don't want to see. Tomb from them, Temple from us. We're going to Scry. Get Rock to the bottom. We want to draw lands here so we can go Harbinger into Great Henge into, well, any other body in the deck, really. Okay. We drew a land. Harbinger it is. Let's go. Harbinger should find us bodies to fuel the Great Henge as well, so we can just creep ahead in Card Advantage. I assume we're going to see an Uro here. Unless they go fourth land extinction? No, they've got Tamiyo. Okay. Tamiyo's gonna go searching for an extinction event. I think you will find my what do they choose? They choose! They're thinking long and hard. Shark Typhoon, they didn't hit it. Also, Garrick's Harbinger triggers when it hits Planeswalkers. That's pretty sweet. Let's go ahead and slap their Tamiyo. Trigger, find no creature, no Garrick. Garrick's in our hand. We only play one. But it's the creatures that it wants to find. Maybe my creature count is too low. I haven't even counted it after the last couple of revisions to the deck. Do you want to play removal spells and elaborate creatures with too much text, right? That's our MO. So Uro comes into play, they draw a card, they put a land into play. That land is the Watery Grave that we knew about. Temio ticks up. Sure. Let me aid your research. They name Hydroid Crisis and fail to find it. Let's go to our turn. We draw a Vital Force. Let's kill the Temio and see what we find on top of our deck as well. We get a choice between here and Great Henge and Vital Force. We get a Skooz. We're going to play Skooz. We're going to eat their Uro. That was a pretty good find from the sideboard cards. They have no more creatures in their bin for us to eat. What we will do is we'll eat something on their end step when they have a Temio, in case they get another Temio to take something from there. Graveyard back to play. Nissa who shakes the world, okay. Witness the ties that bind us all. I'm tapping an island, they have three mana after that as well. They have an eliminate. Okay, let's go ahead and just eat. I guess an extinction event in case they get it back with the Temio later to deal with our Harbinger. So if we top deck a land, we can go Garrick, kill the island, hit the Nissa. We did, although we can just trophy the Nissa as another thing as well. Okay, let's go pay two life here. Let's go. Five mana. Vital Force. Tick up on our forest. I'm just going to trophy the Nissa. Because we lost to Nissa last time. And Nissa was like hands down their best card against us. We struggled to do the one for one removal thing and then play decent threats when they're playing like, you know, a 3-3 every turn. That's Vigilant and Hasty, thanks to Nissa. And the mana allows them just to spend. And grumble. Okay. Okay. Not great. They're going to attack with two 3/3s. I'm going to slam this into one of them, protecting our Nissa, killing off one of their lands. We're going to go Cursed Huntsman. We're going to go. We can kill the island and hit Nissa down to one, and then they can swing back and kill my Garrick. Let's do that. Hopefully drawing more removal for the next land thing you play. Okay. Garen Brig. Uptick our Nissa. Make a forest of 5/5. Attack their Nissa down to 1. Let us talk of peace. And then our Nissa should survive, which can uptick and touch in a land to a 5/5, make our Henge only cost 4, which then allows us to play Garrick's Harbinger off of it, which makes a 5/4 Harbinger and draws a card. That's all if they don't have a trophy of their own or something similar to deal with our Nissa. If they go make her 3/3, kill our Garrick, kill our Nissa, then we're probably a bit sad. The land shall conquer you. Well, they floated some mana. Oh! Nissa being the best card against us, they've drawn 3 of them. They have drawn 3 of them. Now they can choose what they kill. And they've got a Thoughtseize as well. Strong. Absolutely very strong. We're going to lose Garrick, and this is going to go down. And now I don't really know how we win, and that is definitely not it. Okay.
just true power.
Okay, we have to do some elaborate blocking and some field of ruining. Ing. So they pit a land, okay.
The land fights.
Just making 3/3s every turn! And there's nothing we can do about it, okay. Let's block here. And then before damage, let's field of ruin this one. Grab a forest out of that. I'm going to field of ruin the next one as well. And then they should be... Oh, I blocked the wrong one comment section. Oh, I've done it to myself. If I blocked the forest and killed the watery grave, that was a huge swing, and I failed. Okay, well... We drew a Vraska, which doesn't do anything here, because it can't destroy. It can't destroy those lands. Cultivate! Watch out, watch out, watch out! Attack the Nissa. I can't believe I blocked the wrong way round! Oh, magic is hard. Okay, Cavalier of Thorns, play a swamp. They now just kill my Vraska, but at least we have a Cavalier follow-up with something else. Just another trophy on the Nissa would be nice. Oh my god, I had the play and I absolutely ballsed it up. Vraska is dead. Vraska is down. What do we draw? We drew the trophy. Lovely. Finally, we can claw our way back into the second game. If they play a fourth in this, so I'm going to do a little poo. I really am. Probably should attack the Garrick first because they wouldn't have blocked. I don't think the Garrick's Harbinger first, I think. And then we would have been able to get in, get some points in. Draw a card, essentially, then the trophy of the Nissa. They have two cards in hand, we have none. If they kill the Cavalier, we get something back. Any of our Planeswalkers, for example. Isn't it fun when every Magic game revolves around Planeswalkers? They got no lands left because we killed most of them. Okay, so they killed our Cavalier of Thorns. We're going to put Garrick back on top of our deck. No blocks. Take 3. My turn, I'm going to draw this. I'm going to go to combat and attack them. I'm happy to trade here because they don't have any lands left. They can't really block this. Yep, sure. Off of the Harbinger we find. Nothing. Okay.
Fuck this. I
make 2 wolves. Found an Uro, which is actually going to be back. Well, they can't cast it out of the bin this turn. So I say backbreaking. It's backbreaking when they recast it next turn. They have to. If we blow up a Triome, though, we're in a good shot. Oh, both at Garrick. So we double block down. We pack Wolf down one of these. It takes 3 but gains 2. And we whittle down their lands again. We get into the red zone with everything. The wolf dies. It grows the Garrick. We get another questing piece, which is legendary, so we can't play the second one until the first one is dead. We're going to kill this forest, because if they don't hit a land drop, they can't play the Uro. Gordon Bennett, what a game of magic. Mid-range mirrors, eh? Mid-range mirrors. Okay, they're going to play the Uro. Just going to draw them a card, put another land into play, stop us from attacking. Although I can attack the Questing Beast. Do they put a ladder to play to catch them back up? It does. Let's crack this field, Pastor. I could hold it off for the Gitrog monster, the singular Gitrog monster. But at this point, I just want to draw things that aren't lands. There we go. That's not a land. Make some wolves. Make a goose. Go to combat. Attack with a questing beast. I mean, they can block with an Uro and just replay it again. Maybe I should attack with a Harbinger then. To force the issue. Yeah, probably should have done. Let's play Garry, a questing beast. They hit a Vantress, which can smooth out their draws. You can play a Krasis for 4, which is a legitimate aerial threat. I draw a Garenbrig. I don't want to know I've drawn a Garenbrig. So we're going to combat and attack with Questing Beast, a 2-2 and a 4-3. They block the 4-3 because it draws us cards. They take 6. We make a load more wolves. Keep Garenbrig in our hand. Oops, they say. Why oops? Sure, they make another Uro, draw another card, gain 3 life, put a land into play, all that jazz. Maybe game 1 when I discarded that Uro, the Ugin, instead of the Henge that was wrong, because I'm not playing as many creatures as I thought I was. I think I might have whittled down the numbers over time. Of playing this every season, I only play this to platinum. Let's crack a food. Go up to 13. My turn. We untap and draw Nugent. Okay. Sure. Let's go to combat and attack with a questing beast and some wolves. They get to replay their Uro again next turn. Isn't this card absurd? Well, they don't because they're dead. Okay, Ugin's going to bolt them down unless they have a counterspell. Does this rodeo continue? Okay, we took a game. How people grind ladder in best of 3, I just do not know. How much of a grind was that? Such a grind. I'm trying to run it back as I did. I think there's an argument for Duress if they're playing main board Wraths, right? If they're playing Extinction Events and stuff, there's an argument for playing Duress. But we've already got 4 Thoughtseize, and Thoughtseize also catches Hydro Krasis. No, I don't think there is that much of a discussion around it, actually. I think it is just straight up, you play the Thoughtseize in this matchup, in the black-green mid-range mess that I'm playing, versus the Bug Sultai mid-range deck of our opponent. Because their creatures are generally that good. Also, like, I don't really know how he beat a Carnage Tyrant by blocking it down with like a plethora of creatures. So being able to hit one in the hand with Thoughtseize is good. I guess a down tick on Nugent would kill a Carnage Tyrant. Our opponent's called Gazpacho, which I'm sure is a type of cold soup. Okay, I punted that game in the middle, but it didn't punish us too bad. Trophy, Cultivate, and Cavalier. I'm going to keep this. Because Cavalier also gives us card advantage and refills our hand as well. And we've got Interaction and we've got Ramp. Nissa is not terrible, so we're going to go Malady. Find a swamp on top of our library. Bottom it. We don't need lands right now. Next time we can go Garenbrig tapped. Turn after we can Cultivate. Thoughtseize here will probably take the Cavalier or the Nissa, I would assume. Unless they've got a decent threat, then they're going to take the Assassin's Trophy. but I feel like they're more mid-range than they are actual control, so having an early game threat is unlikely. They took the Cavalier. And does a lot of the work it does later, like grabbing this land and giving us a permanent back out of the bin and so on. There's a Garenbrig. Our second Garenbrig and our Woodland Cemetery both come and play towns, except for when we're going to cultivate for a forest in seconds. Arrow from our opponent, breeding pool for that, they're on 21. Let's cultivate. Pass back to our opponent. So next time we can just slam a Vital Force, but it's not that... I'm starting to think it's just not as good as... Well, I know it's not as good as Who Shakes the World, right? I have a soft spot for Vital Force. I enjoy playing the card. I like that it's got, like, multiple modes as opposed to just, like, pump out 3/3s and ramp, which is all included in one mode of, Who Shakes the World. God, what a dumb design that Magic card really is. There you have it. Comment section, there you have it. The person who plays the Nissa first often gets ahead. And in our case, it's the wrong Nissa. Okay, so... what do we do here? Make a 5/5? Bring back the Cavalier next turn? I guess if we can do the whole field of ruin their stuff again, unless they pump both their forests up. They might have learnt from game two, to be fair. Overgrown Tomb from our opponent. They have so much mana. They could just make a huge Hydroid Crisis here. They could Uro plus a removal spell here. Or they could slam a Shark Typhoon. And an Elder Gargoth. Okay. That's some card advantage right there with that Gargoyle, that's for sure. Okay, we drew another land, which is less than ideal. Cavalier to hand. Cast Cavalier. Tap out of our black mana, so we're gonna fail to hit a land anyway. Okay. I wanted to hit a green source so we could alongside one keep one of our black sources untapped, which we could have done for Assassin's Trophy, but the auto tapper screwed us, and then we didn't hit a land either. I mean, we are only on 23 lands, so this is never a dead cert. Ugin is in our bin now, though. Both Ugins are in our bin now. So I guess if our Cavalier dies, we get to go ahead and put an Ugin on top of our library. But we only have 6 mana right now. I guess I block like this. We get to put Ugin on top of our library. We get to untap with our Nissa. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. We get to untap with our Nissa and cast an Ugin. That's strange. Do they have another removal spell for the Nissa? Why would they have attacked it, though? Sure. We drew the Ugin. We play the swamp they know about. We float all our mana. Gargoroth is 5, right? And Shark Typhoon is 6. Yeah, so Ugin will actually stick around after this. Our Nissa will not, though. Oh, so are their lands, though, to be fair. This is kind of our only out, though.
It's surprisingly flexible.
Nissa who shakes the world. Did she defeat Ugin in a fight? No, Ugin's a good guy, right? She could defeat him in a fight. On the upside, I didn't fuel the Uro, but they'll kill Ugin here and 6 us. And then we need to draw our Nissa that we're not playing because I'm a fool. But you can't play the same cards all the time. can't. This. Oh my god! Our deck is so bad against who shakes the world, isn't it? It's so bad against who shakes the world. Uptick Vraska, sack a forest. Draw Thought Seize. Okay. End the turn. When their hand is empty and they have two Uros in their bin. Okay, we get to save Vraska here, don't we, with the Assassin's Trophy and take three? Or do they just go to face? Killing off all to face? Nah, two of Vraska, one of face. All of Vraska. Clever. We're going to trophy one of these anyway. Because we want to untap with our full mana for when we draw something that matters. Which I can't imagine is anything at this point. Vraska is there. That was the right thing to do in case we had a removal spell. Okay. Second Thought Seize. Yep, there we are. That's what we needed. Right, so we're on a two-turn clock. Thought Seize is a double-edged sword, right? Although it's almost like... Okay, they can now play an arrow. Thought Seize is a double-edged sword in the fact that it's almost always good. Oh, you Thought Seize me and only find Thought Seizes. Yeah, so the bad edge of that double-edged sword is rather small. Oh god, our opponent's gonna last 9 minutes. Okay, so Ugin's like our only out here and we can't draw one, so I think we're just dead. No way! No way! Okay, pay two life. Thought Seize them. I Thought Seize and find a Thought Seize! And then we're just gonna end our career with another Thought Seize. So, alright, let's try another round, because that was brutal. Okay, we're going at it again. Another mid-range mirror is not what I want to see. Our opponent's won the die roll. I'm not making changes. Like, I'm aware of the issues with the deck, but I like Vital Force too much to cut her. Okay? Like, sometimes you've got to play your pet cards and then complain when you lose them. Okay? That's just... it's a rite of passage within Magic. This hand is unkeepable. Even if this is a forest, I would not keep this. This hand is pretty bad too. But going to five doesn't seem so hot. Let's bottom the uncastable Noxious Gearhole. Keeping the uncastable Cavalier of Thorns. I say that, we're only one off. And Cultivate gets us there. Our opponent has kept a seven. We are on the draw though, so we're on a virtual lead on the seven as well. Blood Crypt from our opponent. Sorry, it's Scorpion from our opponent. Is it Black Red Sacrifice? Garenbrig taps. Let's go. Almost F6 there, because I'm so used to Modo. Dragon Skull Summit from our opponent. Blood Arts from our opponent. They are definitely some sort of Aristocrat Sacrifice deck. We untap and we draw a Cavalier of Thorns, because the first one is never enough. We play our land or what else, which we really don't want to see claimed and then sacked, but it might get claimed and sacked. It's not what we want to see, but sometimes you just... Okay, they've tapped out for a Bastion of Remembrance. It makes a 1-1 human soldier. Whenever a creature you control dies, each opponent loses one of your one life. It's another Blood Artist effect. We get hit by another Scorpion. We're going to go Cultivate. We're going to grab Swamp and Forest. We're going to put the Swamp into play. We're going to play the Forest for turn. We're going to play a Land of White Elves. Now, I should have got Swamps for the Massacre Worm there, honestly. But I wanted to play that Land of White Elves so bad that turn. So we're now going to play Cavalier of Thorns next turn to try and find another Black Source. And Field of Ruin can be our third Black Source to their Massacre Worm their board. We'll take a load of damage, but they'll also take a load of damage. We'll probably take more damage than they will, which is a bit sad. Judith! Serrated Scorpion. Okay, we're in trouble if we wrath their board. Like, we might have to, like, Assassin's Trophy the Judith first. No blocks. Take two. Find an overgrown tomb. Play a Cavalier of Thorns. Hit a forest. Good game! What?! That's so rude! What is with people? Pay to life. They've obviously got a sack out there in hand, right? That's what that means. We take 2 life for every time a creature I control dies. Sure. There comes the Bastion of Remembrance. Sure. Oh. Yeah, there you go. That's a lot of damage. How much is that? A lot. So now we kill the Jude, and then we die to the triggers again, right? Because we take 1 from the Jude, 2, 3, 4. Wait. Whenever non-target. Yeah. So we take 4 here. Yep. Oh, they drew another village rights. Okay, they got us. The preemptive good game was probably worth it. Although it's still really rude. People should not do that, in my opinion. Right, let's play Massacre Worm, let's play Massacre Girl, let's play Scavengers, let's play Pushers, let's play a Trophy. Let's cut the Thought Seizers. Let's cut the... Okay, so I'm just asking my wife politely to sort the dogs out. Cut a questing beast. Noxious Gearhawk doesn't seem too hot. Neither is Garrick Huntsman. Not sure about Vraska. Vraska kills things, we want Vraska. We'll cut and henge. We just want every card in our deck to kill something from their deck, right? Cogler destroying those enchantments is pretty good. I probably should have started the second Cogler in over the Henge, actually. So post-board, if we get to a game 3, we're bringing in a Cogler. This is bad. It's Mulligan. Okay, acceleration, a Scooze, ramp, and a creature that kills stuff. Let's do this. I probably have to put Poly KK on the bottom of my library, don't I? Yeah, I probably do. Forest Llanowar Elves. Next turn we can cultivate, and then just hopefully just draw gas from there. Let's cultivate. Grabbing one of each. Dreadhole Butcher. Okay, let's go with Cavalier of Thorns. That should roadblock the Butcher for a while. When the Butcher dies, he can even bolt us or kill our Llanowar Elves. That's why I couldn't kill it prior to casting that Cavalier of Thorns. We had to make sure we got to our 5-mana and played, well, one of our 5-mana things. This icon for Revolt is very strange. Oh, I keep thinking it's like a peanut or like a seed cracking. Okay. What will they take here? Probably the push. If they've got a Judith and stuff in hand, take the push. I take the Scooze. They don't want to gain life. Fair enough. Okay, we get to untap and play a Pelucranus. Play Gilded Goose. Hit them for 5. As you get better at closing games out when playing decks like this, like combo decks, aggro decks, I guess I should probably approach this similar to how you approach D&T, right? Like, D&T doesn't turn a corner then end conclusively. It often has to race and, yeah, out-leverage your opponent into the small increments of damage. So maybe I do know how to play these, I just don't play them very well. Well, I know I don't play them very well. That's not the... That's not really a question. So we have push up and they're aware of it. We have 6 cards in hand, 3 mana currently. A Dreadhold Butcher that can kill both our Goose and our Llanowar Elves. It's a shame. Maybe I should have kept the Goose back till after we kill the Dreadhold Butcher. I'm going to kill the Butcher now. Because the Goose gains us like quite a bit of life. Yeah, there's the Goose gone. But they are dead on board right now, right? Do I good game them here? Because it looks like good game here. Oh, good game them now they've surrendered. Okay. Good, 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 good. That went a lot better. That went a lot better. Much better, some might say. Coglet is probably better than an Ugin. Not definitively. I mean, it ETBs and kills something on their side of the board. And then when it attacks, it blows up that enchantment. Which they're probably playing 4 of because it's a Blood Artist effect. Okay. Let's go. Removal spells, creatures, ramp, creatures. I'm going to say this feels safe in this matchup because of the hexproof and black, but like I said, they could have claimed the firstborn to steal it and sack it. Okay, we draw Llanowar Elves, which is pretty tasty here. Our best possible draw on turn 1. I'm going to play a Blood Artist, okay. We're going to take a turn off to cultivate, which will give us enough mana to be able to scooze, keep mana up, and Heartless Act the Blood Artist next turn. Now, of course, that does leave open our removals, our singular only removal spell to getting Thought Seized. But they did prioritize removing the scooze last time over the removal spell, the push that was in hand. The second blast. We've drawn Maelstrom Pulse. We did not draw Maelstrom Pulse. That's a shame. Let's go. Swamp. Not misclick and remove counters. That would suck. That trigger was very delayed. So yeah, we take 2, they gain 2. We play a Skooze. And we say no attacks and turn. I'd rather eat the Blood Artist and gain the life than attack with a 1-1. Knight of the Ebon Legion, sure. Which has its ability up at the moment. Midnight Reaper, sure. We're going to eat their Blood Artist now. So Reaper will refill their hand over time. So Cavalier. Let's grab a Fabled Passage. Cockle into the graveyard. Pelucas into the graveyard. Fabled Passage again. I guess I attack with a Skooze here. No, do I? Yeah, I do. I can eat a Cockle to grow big enough to fight this Reaper. So take them to 19. It's not a huge dent. I'm probably going to eat the Questing Beast in my bin at the very least. Maybe I should have done that before damage there. Judith. Okay. Let's crack these now. Grabbing some forest, thinning our deck, giving us access to resources for Scavenging Ooze. I love Scavenging Ooze. What an incredible piece of design. It's not oppressive, it feels good. We're going to keep Cogler in our bin. Where are we going to keep Cogler in our bin? Yeah, we are. Garenbrig. Activate. Play up Lucanus. We can't keep Conqueror on our bin. I misunderstood. So you used to escape 5 or whatever. Yeah, Uro's escape 5, right? God, I'm glad I did that now. And then we're going to activate this with our remaining mana. And it's going to fight the Judith. They get to draw a card. We'll take one, they take one. They'll gain one, we lose one. We attack with a 5/6, it gains Death Touch, and then we get nothing back. So, no attacks just yet. Trading their 1 drop for our 5 drop and us getting nothing out of it. Doesn't seem that hot. Defeat the Swarm to kill. Okay, and I take 6 for that. And the Knight of the Ebon Hand grew. Okay, let's go, Goose. Harbinger. And then we'll go to combat and we'll attack the Cavalier, because the Cavalier can put Pelucros back in our hand now. They take 5. End turn. They've got one body in the bin for us to eat with the Skooze. Another knight. They can't pump both. Eat both things in their yard just to be on the safe side. Know what recursion red black has access to in historic these days? Black can destroy enchantments now, so why can't I just, like, you know, recur spells? They can definitely trade an Ebon Legion. Well, I say trade, they can survive this spring with this thing if they want to. Yep. And that puts Pelucanus back onto Vol Library. Cool, and that'll allow us to draw Pelucanus and fight with the next turn. They now have managed to pump both Ebon Knights, Ebon Legions. We draw Pelucanus, we play Pelucanus. And we start by fighting the Bloodhurst, because it's no damage to Pelucanus. We'll lose one, but it stops offsetting the Midnight Reaper damage. And then we'll end, no attacks, end the turn. We'll eat the blood arts on their end step. And maybe fight the Midnight Reaper. 3 cards in hand. Remembrance. Okay, we're going to eat this. And then we're going to fight the Reaper before that comes down as well. Kill the Reaper. They take 1. With our mana, we can fight one of the knights. They can go to power up and then we can fight it again. Dreadhorde Butcher. It's a Temple of Malady. Not ideal. But the square isn't terrible. Yeah, put that on the bomb. We're going to attack with a Garrix Harbinger. And a Scavenging Ooze. Hmm. Okay, no blocks from the Harbinger, and they're going to pump against the Skooze. And then we're going to fight it back before that resolves. Sure. They take four and we draw a card. Well, hopefully. Cogler. There it is. Cogler. Cogler fights the other knight. Cool. They're saying nice now. That is nice that they're saying nice. Do they flunge? Guess you gotta be careful with Skooze. It can get claimed and it can also be huge. Eat all the things in their yard. Skooze doing God's work here. Keeping us alive, being a threat. Oof. What a lovely boy. Let's go ahead and remove a blocker. Sure. Where's that one damage going at an elf? Yeah, sure. We're going to kill the Dreadhold Butcher here as well. With all of that on the stack, kill another one. This Pelucanos is doing insane amounts of work as well. So they go up. We lose a Llanowar Elves. Lose two Llanowar Elves. They draw two cards. We go to combat. Destroy the Remembrance. So maybe I should have done that fighting during combat after destroy the Remembrance. That probably would have made more sense. Okay, we got there. They got there. There you go. Their deck can just provide too many threats. Oh, look at me climbing. Watch out. Whoa. Four pips for best of three? Huh, careful. I'll get addicted. Okay, here we go. Paired down to silver this time. I lost to bronze. Can I beat the silver menace? And by menace, I mean just an opponent in silver. But are they going to play bug midrange? Is it going to be Uros and Nissas and stuff like that? Because I don't know if I can do another 40-minute game. It's just, I don't have the attention span anymore, right? It's 2020. I'm sat at home a lot in my underwear. 40 minutes for one match of a game? Are you crazy? What is this, League of Legends? This will be our last round of the video. Thank you for joining me. If you've made it this far, I hope you've enjoyed my musings and you haven't hated my play too much. This hand is slow. I'm going to mulligan. This hand is worse. I'm going to mulligan. This hand is better. Let's put Cavalier on the bottom. Let's put Titan on the... Cogler on the bottom. I'm sure we'll be fine. Our opponent's played a blue-green land. We've drawn another 5-drop. Let's go Swamp. Let's go Thoughtseize. Show what you're working with. Oh, it's bloody Uro. Honestly. Can I be bothered? Well, we've just mulliganed. Okay, let's go ahead and... I'm going to take the sensor. So that I can actually play some spells when I draw them. What a soul-crushing hand to see on the mulligan to 5, right? Uro, Teferi here of Dominaria and a sensor. There goes the Uro. There she goes again. That's my little song about Uro. Because it's always going. We have not hit our third land drop. Just spam the spacebar. Looks like I'm going to scoop it up in a second. Opponent casts a second Uro. I think one of the issues with cards like Uro that put you so far ahead is that when an opponent or yourself, when you're playing against it, when you like stumble, when you get a little bit screwed by variance, like mulliganing to five there and not hitting our third land drop, the advantage that Uro gives you, the three life, the card drawn, the land into play, that is good when you're on parity. When you're behind, it is brutal. Like, it's unbelievably bad. So there's some sort of control deck. So... but they're a control deck with Uros? I don't know. Three Juras in, four Thoughtseize out. I don't even know if that's right. Two Tyrants and a Shifting Ceratops. We're going to cut Fatal Push. We're going to cut Heartless Act. Let's run that back. Let's run that. I couldn't do the 40-minute games. So let's mulligan to Oblivion and only have a 5-minute game. Magic the Gathering. Behave. I'll probably take a little bit more time to sideboard, which is nice to see. It's nice to see not everyone is as clueless as I am. We'll play first. No lander. Four lander. Keeping. Putting Gitrog back. Let's go Forest. Okay, we're going to... I didn't want to go to five. This hand is not good, but I didn't want to go to five. Also, if we can, like, Juresa, Wrath of God away, and then land a Carnage Tyrant, we might be loving life. Also, Great Hand is very, very good against this deck. This style of deck. The control deck that wants to attrition us out. That said, when it's splashing green and got card advantage in the early game, like Uro in this Growth Spiral, and also it does have Alancers of the Great Hand, just not like an instant win, because they also have Teferi here of Dominaria... and probably Baby Teferi as well. I forget what's banned in Historic. Is Baby Teferi even legal these days? I can't keep track. Uro number one from our opponent. I like the fact that I've told myself not to play Uro today, but this video has still been dominated by Uro. Mistakes were made in design, Wizards. Mistakes were made in design. All right. Let's slam Walker after Walker after Walker. There is no Force Spike in this format, right? It's just Sensor at 2 mana. I saw it for a second and my heart skipped a beat. But no, that was just the cycling of the Sensor. I'm not going to sacrifice a permanent. I'm just going to decline there. What do I even want to see from our opponent here? What are we happy to see? Uro number 2. Of course. Of course. They have Sensor Mana up. Do I slam a 5-drop into Sensor Mana? No, I don't think I do. Cultivate. Put a Swamp into play tapped. I think I'm going to sacrifice for that Swamp, though, to dig a bit deeper into our deck. Okay, Lana, what else? There's plays around Sensor and similar. Not Dovin's Veto, though. Dovin's Veto might still get us. Aether Gust of Vraska. Put on top. Yeah, go on then. So playing Nissa into Aether Gust there would have been a bit rough. They're going to keep their mana up, aren't they? Okay, let's force them to tap out for a Wrath next turn. Carnage Tyrant! Rrr, grr, be scared! Be afraid! I guess annoyingly it's a 7-6, so it gets blocked by Uro pretty well. Yeah, if they just cantrip again, then cast an Uro next turn. I guess we can then go Vraska, kill the Uro. But then they'll have mana up to stop our Vraska, maybe? Okay, they couldn't Sensor the Carnage Tyrant. A, it can't be counted, and B, we could have paid for it. Could they Aether Gust it? Is it worded that way? It is. Don't Aether Gust me, bro. Don't Aether Gust me. The just a long pause. I was miles away thinking what could happen next. So they get to, we get to hit them for one with Elf here. They get to untap, they get to cast an Ura out of their bin, which is a 6-6 that can trade with the Carnage Tyrant. I'm going to slam Henge into Vraska. That's my plan. Henge our backup if we have to keep drawing creatures into this control deck. Vraska being a way to kill Uro and get in with our Carnage Tyrant. They do play Wrath of God. They do play Wrath of God. We've got 4 mana up post Uro. Five mana up post Uro because they shocked themselves, which is alarming, I won't lie. Let's go, Great Henge. They know we've got Vraska as well. That's the problem here. It's known information. Do they let Great Henge resolve, though? Because that makes every one of our creatures a cantrip from here on out. Which is something our control decks will struggle with. Okay, so that does resolve. That's nice. Now this is going to get countered. Do I just slam a Cavalier here? Let's slam a Cavalier. They can't attack into it because it'll be a 6-7. It's going to draw us a card and ramp us a land. There's the counter spot that we knew they had that I didn't want them to get Vraska with. No attacks. Land from our opponent, 3 cards in hand. They can attack with Uro. It'll gain them life and draw them a card. If they attack with Uro, maybe I trade with the Tyrant and then try to get the Tyrant back with Nissa. That said, they have 4 cards in yard at the moment, so they're only one off being able to recast an Uro again. So if I trade with it and then they go Growth Spiral Replay Uro, I feel pretty silly. They did not charge into it. Okay. Let's cast this Vraska, see what happens. Aether Gust. Top of our library. Okay, let's go Nissa. Does this get Aether Gusted as well? Do they have like double Aether Gust? No, it doesn't.
I will protect the virtue of this world.
I guess I'm gonna just turn a land into a creature.
Behold nature's true power.
So yeah, we're looking alright against a control deck with Great Henge and Vital Force in play. We're looking alright. They got some sort of end of turn action here. They're hovering over their lands. Cycle a Shark Typhoon to a 6-6 to kill my Nissa. That's not what we wanted to see. Shark Typhoon doing God's work there. Vital Force is dead. We have 3 cards in hand. 2 cards in hand. What's the likelihood they ever waited out to the Vraska again? The thing is, the Vrak is more likely to tap tick up now, I think. I dice to the shark anyway. So I've got to kill the shark. Otherwise the shark's going to be able to block our tone anyway. No attacks. Don't shark me again, bruh. Friend, no. Okay, a 1-1. That threatens my Vraska if they swing with the Uro and the 1-1. I guess Llanowar Elves is going under the bus, my friend. I'm going to try and keep Vraska alive here. They get to recast their Uro, which is pretty brutal, but anything to draw us cards, right? Anything to draw us cards. We're going to replay her out of the graveyard, which draws them a card, gains them 3 life, makes a land drop. I'm so tired of it. I'm so tired of this card in every format. in every format. Maybe I need to only pay Pauper from now on. Okay, that's not good. Should really float mana before I let's resolve. Never mind. Drew a cultivate. Well, GG. If I was playing Uro in my deck, to be honest, then maybe I wouldn't be in such a bad spot. That is true. Field of Wound does nothing here, but well, no, it doesn't. It blows up the Arden Veil, but I don't get a land out of it. Cool. Well, thanks for watching. I came into this thing I was going to enjoy Historic. Not going to lie. Having to play two different matches against Uro. Kind of done with it already. Has there been a magic card like Uros and Okos in the past that were just so obnoxious? Venom 6 and Legacy was pretty bad. Cavalier of Thorns is a good counter spell. Cool. Yep.
You know what?
Good game. Thanks for watching. I've been Vince, also known as Pleasant Kenobi on the internet. I'll be making more content, hopefully, where Uro can't disturb us in other formats some other time over on my channel, which is youtube.com/PleasantKenobi. Don't forget, if you've at least enjoyed hanging out and just laughing at the absurdity of Thoughtseize being everywhere, in both hands, multiple times, or the absurdity of Uro being borderline omnipresent, I guess, in so many formats, then hit that like button. Don't forget to smash that bell. And I'll see you all soon. Ta-ta for now. Bye-bye.